So we're just going to do a quick special episode tonight, speaking to an Aston Villa fan and part of the Love McGrath pod. Neil, how are you?
I'm very good. Thanks very much, guys, for having me on.
No, thanks for joining. And Deej, how are you, sir?
Doing good, doing good.
Good. I think everyone can guess the topic. We've recently just announced that we have a new technical director, Johan Lange. Is that right? You might pronounce it better, Neil. You corrected me earlier.
Johan Lange is how everybody I know has pronounced it, and everybody in other podcasts, Villa podcasts. But I don't think I've ever actually heard him say his name.
we'll just go with Lange. I'll just say it's that until someone corrects us. But it would just be like really interesting for us Tottenham supporters to understand maybe a bit about the history of the person that's taking over seemingly from who we've got at the moment, Fabio Paratici. Like from our perception as fans, we've seen Villa go from being this huge, enormous club, you know, it was Spurs, Villa and Everton, where they seem to be the big three outside the big four, as it were. And then Villa just went through this unfortunate like dive into the Championship, and now they've come back and they seem to be going from strength to strength. And obviously every Spurs fan's here going to be saying, please say it's all because of Johan Lange, this miracle worker we've just signed. But maybe there's more to it. You've mentioned to us just before we start recording that there's conflicting feedback on things he's done at Villa. Do you want to tell us a bit about him and his time there?
Yeah, so firstly, I suppose when he came into the club was in 2020. So Villa had their first season in the Premier League when he came into the club. They had Pitash was the man at the helm, the technical director, the director of football, whatever you want to call it, at Villa. And when Villa came up and bought those 11 or 12 players, likes of Douglas Luiz, Bjorn Engels, Trezeguet, making Anwar El Ghazi's loan a permanent deal, when all those guys were under Pitash at that period of time, Ezri Konsa as well was another person who came in under Pitash. Pitash got the road at the end of that year, not because he particularly did anything wrong per se, but I think that there might have just been conflict about where the club wanted to go, and signings that wanted to be made. And then step forward, the man we're speaking about today, Johan Lange. So he comes into a club with Dean Smith, obviously, as the manager at the helm. And in his first off-season, he got, I think Ollie Watkins was his big ticket signing. But what I would say about Johan Lange is, Johan Lange, so you mentioned there that there was conflicting kind of feelings towards him. And I think really it is, I think it's, for me, it took me a long, long time to understand what his role was with the club. And that's not a negative. That's just because he had an overarching role at the club, essentially. We were going through, like we had Christian Perslow in there and we had Johan Lange, and that's who it seemed to be were the two figureheads at the club. But realistically, while he was tasked, and in the cold light of day, when I look back at it today after he left the club, I went, you know what, he's been tasked with more of a football administration job, of building structures. He brought the likes of, he was instrumental in building up the youth system that we have at the moment, the scouting system, making it more robust, bringing in Rob McKenzie, who was with, I've been reliably informed, was with Spurs previously that I didn't know, but obviously the man, Rob McKenzie, who unearthed Riyad Mahrez and N'Golo Kante for Leicester. And I had a tweet that went out, actually, and a lot of people jumped on that thinking that that was Johan Lange, but it wasn't. I was still referencing Rob McKenzie in the secondary tweet. So in case anybody saw that, that was lost in translation. But the moral of the story here was that he was brought in at that period of time to bring a lot of stability. But I'd stayed up on the last day of the season with a draw at West Ham. We needed to push on. And in our next season, we did. We finished 11th. And we had that wonderful start to the season, beating Liverpool 7-2. And, you know, that great start under Dean Smith. But it did peter away afterwards. Obviously, nothing to do with him. But we had increased, the squad, the quality within the squad. So, like, you could get 10 Aston Villa football fans on here. And you'll have three people who have one set of opinions on him, three people who have another opinion on him, and three people who have another opinion on him. And it really goes down to your basis of what did you actually think he did at the club. I firmly believe he was a very, very good football administrator. He was able to negotiate contracts, negotiate deals for players. And if a manager came to him and said, I want this player, he was able to get it done. And we can see the proof is in the pudding with the likes of Ollie Watkins, who was an absolute Dean Smith darling. brought into the club, big money, took the risk, took the gamble, and got him into the club. Steven Gerrard then comes into the club. We see big money signings, or the big risk and gamble was Philippe Coutinho. Johan Lange didn't go and scout Philippe Coutinho and go, he's going to be a great addition to this club. He was told by Steven Gerrard, this is a guy I want to bring to the club.
Interesting.
And Lange delivered again. You know, he delivered on that one too. So this is the picture I'm painting, and it's not a narrative that I'm trying to spin. It's more so sitting back and looking at it. And I genuinely only realized it in the last couple of hours, probably how influential he was in getting deals over the line, as opposed to being the talent identifier. He let people do that job.
Interesting.
He wasn't a meddler. He left them to do that job, but he seemed to be the guy that got things over the line.
Okay, so we don't want to mistake him for like kind of a chief scout role or as a talent identifier. He's much more of a, I want X, your job is to go get it. And he's the man who kind of does that piece of
that. Yeah, obviously oversees the scouting side of things, built the structures there underneath, with people underneath him. But at the end of the day, and he would have been monumental in the transfer committee, if you want to call it that way. But when you kind of distill it all down, you know, and you look at the players that we've signed, it's very much been a case of scouting by committee, and then it's been handed over to somebody to do the work. But he's more of a structure builder and an administrator, from my view, looking back and seeing what he achieved at Aston Villa, and specifically the role that he went into after Monchi joined, was very much a structure builder and a coordinator from that point of view. You know, so. That's where I think his skills lie.
And big question for me, Deej, don't know if you're feeling the same. How good is he at selling players? Because this is Tottenham are constantly burdened with dead wood. We seem to be great at signing people at the moment, and absolutely terrible at getting rid of players we no longer need. Even if they're good, you think players to you outside, you might think like, surely it's easy to get rid of Højbjerg, Dier, Lloris. There's a home for them somewhere. But we just can't shift these kind of players. Have you got a track record of selling players as well?
I'll buy Højbjerg off you right now. I'll buy him off you right now this minute. So there's no problem there. So consider him gone. Does he have a track record in selling players? Do Aston Villa ever have a track record in selling players? Is probably the question. I'm going to say his track record doesn't jump off the page to me. We've not. You know, obviously we got 100 million for Jack Grealish, but look, that's a generational talent that comes through the academy. Mm. And to be honest with you, I think that Christian Perslow stepped in on that on the owner's behest to get in there, and because they were negotiating a new deal anyway. And I think Perslow just went in and goes, right, I'm going to milk this cow as far as I can get it. Mm. And so I don't think he was solely responsible for that. But is he responsible for big, massive sales? It's hard to know, because Aston Villa haven't been very good at selling players anyway. And usually when we buy players, I think that there's no other club in Premier League history that have bought players like Aston Villa. The second you buy them, you have a 50 to 100% depreciation on their value almost. And they have to build their value back up. Albeit we're now in a different situation now. But like recently, we've been very bad at selling players. We've had to let a lot of players go on free transfers. We've had to loan a lot of players out, get their wages off the books as opposed to selling them. So I suppose, to be honest with you, I'm probably going to say no, he hasn't been very good. But then again, the caliber of player we had were, you know, we were never going to really recoup an awful lot of money on some of the players we wanted to get rid of anyway. So it's probably chicken and egg side of things. And I don't think he's solely to blame for it. Without a shadow of a doubt, I don't think he's to blame.
This sounds really, really familiar to another club that I'm aware of.
It does sound like we're a match made in heaven in terms of that, then. And in terms of, like, did you feel the stability now Aston Villa find themselves in is anything to do with the structure he might have set up inside the club?
Absolutely. His legacy is being a figurehead over three managers. And when you bring in somebody like Unai Emery, who has the end of the season like he has last season, and you look at him and you go, you really are going to be our cash cow. You know, you're going to be the. It's going to be your show as long as you want it. Essentially, you have to give him Monchi. And then when Monchi came in, Johan Lange's role was changed. So Johan Lange was doing Monchi's role. It was changed. The whole structure even above him was changed. Perslow out, Chris Seck in, and we've had numerous different appointments since. They've actually already hired Johan Lange as replacement as well. So I think this has been in the offing. This could have been in the offing since the summer. It really could have. And I don't think this is like something that just came to agreement tonight. But I think to answer your question, the structure at Aston Villa now is very much in place. It's robust. It's lasted through three managers, as I say, Dean Smith, Steven Gerrard. And Steven Gerrard brought in a pile of backroom staff. It cost nearly as much to evict Steven Gerrard's backroom staff as it did to evict Steven Gerrard. So he brought in a ton of stuff, a ton of people with him, analysts and all this kind of stuff. But that's the one thing that Johan Lange will back a club with. He's very modern, contemporary kind of methodologies. He does believe in data-driven scouting. He does
Oh,
believe in
interesting.
very much so, and I know Daniel Levy spoke about that in the off season for you guys, but does believe in that. He does believe in traditional methods of scouting. He believes that if there's a viewpoint or if there's a data point, you're better off having it. You're better off throwing it across the table and seeing it all in the cold light of day before you make your decisions. And very much so, he's done that with our youth setup as well. Like, we literally have gone West Brom and moved it to over to the opposite side of over o into the middle of Birmingham into Bonnymoor, because we've taken literally every single one of their good talents, since Mark Harrison came into the club. But Lang has backed that, about being really big and taking a gamble on young kids, bringing them in, and then also allowing managers to elevate those to the first team.
First team, great.
We're seeing that now with the likes of O'Mari Kellyman. Brought him in from Derby. Was it Derby or Sheffield United? I always get confused. I think it was Derby. And he's played a couple of games for us this season. Jacob Ramsey obviously came up through the youth academy. And there's a couple of other players as well that have been knocking around our first team as well. So,
Interesting. The
yeah.
timing, by the way, that's definitely something that's been in the offering, because what happened with us is we signed a guy called Scott Munn, who's meant to be that position above Langer, basically. But Daniel Levy gets this has a lot of criticism, a lot of let's say people who want him out the club, and blah blah blah, all that kind of is going on. The worst thing he could do for his own PR would be to be seen as choosing the technical director for Tottenham, when we don't have a chief football officer in place. So what's happened is we had to wait for Scott Munn to start, who was on gardening leave from Man City. He started about a month ago, and I think it's a case of, like, let's give it a month to make sure everyone knows this was Scott Munn's selection and not Daniel Levy's choice in technical director. We all know Scott Munn's been working behind the scenes for the last 3 4 months. There's pictures of them, of Daniel Levy and Scott Munn at airports and stuff, having coincidental coffees because they're on the same flight. What a coincidence. But yeah. Dee, did you have any questions or thoughts so far?
Yeah, I did a little bit of reading on him before earlier this week because we'd seen links to him, and everything that I've read has been really really good, I guess, for lack of a better term. I read into a bit more of his time at Copenhagen as well, because because I figured that that Jim would probably find someone from Aston Villa to give the insight there, so I figured I'd have to take one step back to bring anything new to the table. And I think that everything that we've heard so far has kind of been echoed at his time at Copenhagen. He believes a lot in data-driven scouting. I saw a quote, or maybe it was paraphrased, but something about him setting like data-based parameters for players, and then once you narrow it down to like a short list, then you go scout the players in person, which I think is probably the best way to use data-driven scouting, because obviously there isn't data is great, but at the end of the day, the eye test, you still have to pass the eye test, I think. There are plenty of great players.
DJ, you being a man from the United States, you'd be familiar with the NFL combine and so on and so forth. There's no it's and I know not everybody that goes to that is a perfect specimen. Well, they're perfect specimens. God, they're definitely a perfect specimen in comparison to me, but they're not a perfect pick. But like with how NFL teams would scout players, you have certain wide receivers who need to run a certain speed. You have linemen who need to be able to bench press X, or have to be able to go through a three cone in a certain system. That's, like, to me, that is absolute, like, it's a no-brainer that you would have a type of player or certain parameters. So, well, and what you're saying is true. that the likes of Mohamed Trezeguet, that was signed for Aston Villa, was I read a piece on that where he was signed obviously because he was a decent player, but he was signed because of his that type of money ball approach, that kind of the tangibles he could bring that you could see on the stat sheet. And then they obviously went and watched him and went, yeah, this guy can cut it in the Premier League. And while he wasn't this outstanding player, he kept us up in that very last season, in the first season, should I say, that we were in the Premier League. So
interesting.
Yeah, you're right.
And who was, I guess, to be a good thing to finish off, who do you think was your best signing under Langer?
Ooh, I suppose you have to go to Ollie Watkins, don't you? I'm just plugging in my phone here, apologies.
I was going to say, what about Emery?
Yeah.
Because I guess he chose the managers, right? Yeah, so you could say a poor appointment was Gerrard, but Emery was a great appointment, and so was Dean Smith in his own right, I think, for what you needed at the time. So
Smith was there already prior to Johan Lange, but Emery, I think Emery was probably picked by the owners and Perslow, truth be known, because I don't think Lange had auspices on that. I think best signing Ollie Watkins, probably closely followed by, it's hard to say whether he had a hand in Moussa Diaby currently, but Boubacar Kamara, free transfer, definitely had to do an awful lot of negotiations in that one. So I think Boubacar Kamara and Ollie Watkins for certain.
And actually, to one more, as he's responsible for bringing players in some regard, like, does he tend to move early in transfer windows or late in transfer windows, all over? Like,
yes. early for sure. Early. We've done a lot of our business early in transfer. Like, don't be expecting anything deadline day. But then again, he's the guy who puts the work in there and then allows people to do it. He'll push the button when the button needs to be pushed. So whether that was a managerial decision or whether it was a board decision whereby we do all our business early is yet to be known.
Interesting. Well, thanks, Neil. I hear your little one's awake, so we'll let you get back. But thanks very much, everyone. If you enjoyed the pod, check out LoveMcGrathPod if you're just a general football fan. And thank you, Neil, for joining. Yeah, Deej, I guess the Spurs is down to us too, unless you had any final comments.
I was just going to say, I think that the one thing that I found that was interesting about the way that Lange sets up his, I guess, scouting network is that it does still leave room for someone, a particular criminal of ours, to have input. because for as much as I hated the way that he looked at managers, I guess the most recent one was okay. As much as I hated the way he looked at managers, man, he knows how to find young talent, and that is invaluable. I mean, just he's made so many good signings for us, and I'm glad that he's potentially staying on a consultancy role. Obviously, we'll have to see in the future, but it does sound like, given that Lange is more based around setting up a good scouting network and setting up a good data-driven approach, which is something that it sounds like we've already tried to do, that someone who is more quote-unquote in the weeds with players specifically would definitely still have a place to be as like a consultant. So hopefully we get to see a bit more of our favorite Italian stallion.
Yes, yeah, it will be second favorite. Although I would second punch you, I would say the one thing on Prachi is getting a lot of praise at the moment for his transfers, and quite rightly so, because the vast majority are exemplary at the moment. But there is a little bit of me that says they're partly exemplary because, bigger picture, Ange is the best man to take a lot of young players. But that's okay. He probably was involved in choosing Ange as well, so I've got to give credit there too. But he did desperately want Traore.
desperately want Traore. I think so, that is. I think blotch. we give him only. He's only allowed to look at players below the age of 23. I think that's what we have to tell him.
That's a good idea. But it's fantastic. He sounds like the right man. He's data driven. He likes signing youth. He's going to focus on building the academy up even more. And he backs the manager with what the manager wants. So it sounds like, even though Gerrard was, it sounds like an owner's pick for Aston Villa, because it was like the big fancy name, let's bring in Gerrard and make us look great. He went and backed Gerrard regardless if he thought it was the right appointment or not. And that's what I guess you want. You don't want them doing anything else. So we've always complained about Spurs fans. You've always, even when it was Conte, wanted him backed. Now it's Andrew, want him backed. So back the manager. But I guess up the Spurs from there, Deej. Just a mini episode of us two tonight. Plus,
up the
thanks
Spurs
again, Neil. Up the Spurs.